I feel every time I do these episode reviews for Bleach, they're getting more and more lengthier because of the amount of things that are happening into them and the things that I just really want to talk about. So I'm going to try my best to go through this episode and get into the nitty gritty of things that I really want to talk about, because this was a fantastic episode to say the least. So join us as we talk about Heart of Wolf, episode 17 of Bleach, Komamura versus Bambietta. Of course, if you like these videos, hit that like and subscribe because it always helps me out. And with that being said, let's get into it, shall we? This episode starts right off with Giselle and Candice, and the thing that I like about this shot in general is that we get to see the Volstandig wings, and these wings in particular show a great deal of their personality, especially with all the Stoneritters in general when it goes to their Volstandigs, especially when we see Bambietta and the bombs that are attached to hers. With Giselle we see the bone wings, and of course with Candice we see the electrocution wings, or the, you know, static wings, whatever you want to call them. They look great, and I think these Volstandigs are fantastic because we get to see a bit of a smidgen towards their personality and future script for people that are very interested in those characters. That being said, there was a few lines which interested me the most, especially from Giselle talking about being in that form or having those wings out per se makes them very tired, especially Candice said exactly the same thing as well, and it makes me question whether they have enough power or they have enough strength or stamina to keep those wings available, unlike someone like Bambietta, for example. Is this a testament to how strong Bambietta is that she can maybe keep her wings open for like quite a long time in comparison to the other Bambi girls? These are things that quite interested me the most. There was of course another sly remark from Giselle too, saying that Bambi should be the least of them that should be using the Volstandig right now, maybe because she's powerful or maybe because she's dumb, which Giselle does say that Bambietta is dumb, but I don't know whether that's out of spite or whether that is because like it's her nature to be frustrated and uses her, maybe her ability, maybe unprofessionally so to say, which is quite plausible because we then move over to Shinji versus Bambietta, and granted it was for an extremely short amount of time because Shinji absolutely gets dropped literally mid-sentence, which I absolutely found hilarious, which if you haven't seen my live reaction to that, I definitely laughed. It was great, not because, you know, Shinji got bodied, but because of like the state of what Bambietta was in. She didn't care to hear what, you know, Shinji had to say, nor do I think it was purposeful to hit Shinji in that regard. She was just blasting everywhere, and to which makes sense because if, you know, Shinji's Shikai is making everything reversed, her simplicity, or her dumbness, which Giselle says her simplicity to the resolution of this predicament that she's in, is if everything's reversed, I might as well just blast everything in sight from all directions, to which it worked and made this massive AoE type attack, which is good because, you know, Shinji did get hit. But the other cool thing about it is that Shinji was hit multiple times, so he didn't even get a chance to react, which I found was fantastic. Then another thing I can't praise the anime enough is for making sure that they get facial details on point. And what I mean by this is that Kubo is a very expressive person through his facial shots. So to see Bambietta in like her psycho schizo bloodthirsty mode through her facial expressions when Momo was coming down to come and help Shinji was great. I love that. It just speaks volumes about Bambietta's like mindset at that point, so I really enjoyed that shot, and I'm so glad that they had it so on point. Of course, Komamura comes to save, tells Momo to, you know, you can't deflect this, this is something you can't fight, to which Bambietta, again to her credit as well, which I like her as a character, she's not giving Komamura a chance to rest in this situation, making sure she gets in behind him, and of course Komamura reacts swiftly, but of course misses. Goes to show a lot about Bambietta's speed, of course her taunting him at the same time as well. Just goes to show how powerful Bambietta is in this form. And truth be told, I think the Bambi girls also know this as well, but we'll get a little bit more into that as we get on through this review. We then of course get an explanation on Bambietta's abilities, which she's not throwing bombs, she's instead throwing reishi, and whatever that reishi touches, whatever the thing that is being touched, turns into the bomb itself. So she's throwing a reishi ball over to Komamura's armor. That armor itself is in fact the bomb rather than the reishi ball itself, which if you think about it is a pretty broken ability, because in fact it isn't something you can just swipe away. However, there does seem to be a time limit on its detonation, to which again we'll get into that very shortly. Bambietta throws a slew of shots, and of course we get to see Komamura's beautiful macho giga chad face, to which after watching a few live reactors it seems that it turned many women into furries, so and I've heard a few Witcher references as well. But yeah, absolutely got him down just right, and attention to detail on him was done beautifully. Before we do get into any more of this battle, we then of course go into the lore about the Jinka technique. And it would also seem that off screen Kamamura actually did beat the Grand Elder, considering he had like blood on his like fur and whatnot. So there was a fight that did apparently kick off. Again, would have been nice to see that, but then again at the same time, was it really needed? Probably not. So there was a fight that kicked off, Grand Elder lost, and then the Jinka technique was told to him. Whether it was for Kamamura's benefit or the Grand Elder's benefit, we can talk about that as well. But we get a little bit more about the Beast Clan. The clan was in fact sent to the Animal Realm, by whom I don't know, but they committed a bunch of sins apparently, and they ended up returning to the Soul Society. However, by breaking the sins that bind them, they can return to the forms that they once were before being condemned, granting them immense power. So it is safe to assume that this ability or this form that Kamamura has was the original form that he had, or that the clan had in general, before they were condemned to the Beast Realm. Now granted, I'm not going to say everyone in the Beast Realm is OP like Kamamura. Kamamura had to sacrifice something quite important for him to grant himself a very small amount of time for immortality. Like, I imagine the clan's true form, they wouldn't be immortal, probably just having this form and making them be strong and then being nerfed into the Beast forms, but it's hard to say. I would imagine they'd be a little bit stronger than Kamamura usually is, but not to this extent that we actually see here with the immortality. So it's a bit difficult to say how much stronger they would have been. But regardless of what, there was a sin that happened, which I don't think we found out in the manga, but hopefully we find out like more maybe at some point in the anime or some light novel. I don't know. If somebody in the comments knows, feel free to tell me. Very interested in that. Didn't really go much into researching it, to be honest. But what Sajin essentially says, and it is interesting in regards to, you know, the whole lore about revenge, is that Sajin at some point rejected the clan's beliefs or kind of curse or their pride or whatever you really want to call it. He kind of rejected them and then turned his back on the clan. And it seems to me, without going too much into it yet, it seems that what he was saying to Tozen was in fact something he was trying to cope himself with the ideology that his clan once had. So I'm making a huge guess here is that that's why Kamamura like rejected his clan, because he disbelieved in revenge or the concept of revenge. But regardless of what, no hesitation, straight for the heart for Genryu Sai Yamamoto. Absolutely goaded to be able to do that, and it just shows his devoted loyalty to Genryu Sai. Then of course we get the CGI Bankai. Now first and foremost, the thing that you will notice the most is the eyes, the fire in the eyes, and this can represent either time or life itself, to which Kamamura kind of explains. And again, for something that with CG, I was absolutely pleasantly surprised. It looked like a demon, it looked out of place, and that's what it was supposed to be. It worked with its favor. I think if this was drawn, it wouldn't have had the same kind of impact of alienation, which you probably would want in this situation, is that it's not supposed to look human, it's not supposed to look normal to the rest of the characters, it's supposed to look out of place, I think. We then get a differentiation with regards to Tengen Myoho, which is the armor imbued with life, while Dangai Jo is stripped of armor, forming only spiritual pressure and power. So just like someone with Yumichika, for example, the difference of names can definitely play a part in the appearance of a Bankai or how it is used. And did anyone notice Bambietta doing parkour? Well, if you didn't, here's a screenshot, and now you see it. Bambietta doing some flexibility. And we love a girl that can do flexibility. Bambietta then goes to explain that if his spiritual pressure is exposed, then so should his weakness be, which is absolutely true. His spiritual pressure and power is in a actual form, to which is true. Having no armor at all and just having pure spiritual pressure and power would be, in fact, exposing the whole body as a weakness. However, the difference here is Kamamura is immortal. So those weaknesses that would have been there prior to him not being immortal would have been visible night and day. But in this case, because he's immortal, it just has no effect. And that spiritual pressure can just keep regenerating and keep having an attack in poise, so to say. I also did notice throughout this episode as well that the blood of the heart did keep pumping. And it was like the Grand Elder was watching the bowl where the heart was, and it was just filling up with blood, and he was waiting for like the right time for them to devour it. Now, I don't really know what it would symbolize. Was the blood symbolizing like time, or like its maximum output before like it just stopped? Or another symbolism could be the amount of vengeance or resentment that Kamamura held, the more the bowl filled with blood potentially, and maybe that's what it symbolized. But it's up to you guys to interpret, and give me your thoughts in the comment section down below. As the fight goes on with Kamamura and Bambietta, we get to see the ending climax of it all, and that is a beautiful shot of Bambietta's iris reflecting the sword and the bombs at the same time. And this speed must have been so immeasurable that the fact that these bombs were being stuck to the sword but hadn't detonated yet, because the speed of the sword was just that quick that the bombs hadn't even exploded yet. So the time difference for the Reishi balls to react to contact was slower than Komomoros's Danganjo. I forgot how to pronounce it, but Danganjo. And then was also hitting Bambietta at the same time, so she got hit by her own ability, ultimately blasting her to the ground and basically being almost dead. To which then the controversy starts, and we can talk a little bit about that too. Did Giselle do a good thing? Did they not? That is the question. But before we get into that scene in particular, we then see Komamura's transformation. Now, as some of you may know, Yamashita doesn't really put himself in the credits, and I believe that some people were saying that this was Yamashita's shot. I have to say, the transformation itself was fluid, amazing, so many cuts. It was great just seeing like Komamura's reaction to each body part kind of transform into the wolf itself. Not a werewolf, not a humanoid wolf, but an actual doggy wolf itself. And I feel like the thing I most appreciated, besides the paw like turning from a hand into an actual paw, was the fact there was this interesting like ink brush effect of like his fur engulfing his body and then just moving all up towards his head. It was a nice effect, and it was definitely something that Yamashita would do. So it's just the details like that that really made it feel like alive and real, and each frame was drawn individually. And it's just Yamashita is a absolute fucking menace when it comes to animating. So I'm surprised that that's the scene he went for, but I feel like it was probably the most impactful on an emotional level. And I feel like it's a crime that I haven't said this yet, but the epic walk from Danganjo walking all the way up to Yuha's castle, that was an amazing menacing shot. Like, he just done with Bambietta, got her out the way, no time wasted in just leaving her in the dirt. He didn't care if she was dead or not. He was just walking to that castle, and to see this big brolic Chad Bankai just like absolutely steamroll over to Yuha's castle was just an amazing sight. Not only because of like how big and menacing and like this camera shot that was used, but because you get to see two perspectives. One, a close-up shot of him walking, but also the distance of how big Danganjo was from the castle itself as Yuha's watching it. And I can only imagine that Uryu, who was also watching it, was like, I've seen that Bankai before. Don't really want to mess with it. And he was probably like, what is that? What's happened? Why does it look like that? I have never seen it like that before. And I would imagine in Uryu's head, he's like, oh, fuck. You know, like, that looks like an issue. But I think it was such an amazing scene to show Danganjo get up and like stand up from like a really far away distance, just to give you this image of how big this thing is. But of course, as Komamura is turning into a wolf, we do get some flashbacks with Tozen, and again, it's just the irony of it all. The thing of him talking to Tozen about revenge was something he was trying to warn himself of, and I think a lot of people, when they give advice to people, are talking from a place of experience or a place of fear that they themselves could also do, but looking through the lens of somebody else being a bit of a hypocrite, but also, you know, a place of good intentions. But I think Komamura had already dealt with it in his clan, the idea of revenge, and he didn't want to see his friend go down the same route. I think if anyone has an idea of what revenge was, it would have been Komamura. It's just funny how like it all comes full circle for him, and he really couldn't escape his true nature of his clan. And that was at that moment that the elder then goes to sip up that resentment of his heart and eats his heart. And this is what I mean. It kind of seems like a setup from the Grand Elder. Like, yeah, this is what Komamura wanted, and this is what it means for like Komamura coming back to his clan, because he's embodying the resentment that the clan holds pride in, if that makes sense. I wouldn't say it's a curse. Obviously, I would say it's a curse, but for them, they wouldn't say it's a curse. But for someone like the Grand Elder, it almost seems like eating the hearts of those resentments makes it seem like he lasts longer or lives a longer life. And I feel like that was the setup, is that he wanted Komamura, or he wants his clan members to keep resenting so he can live longer, I think. And again, that's kind of like the symbolism I got from it all, is that that's why he did what he did and waited for it to like boil up to its like highest point before he actually ate the heart. Because what else would be the reason to do something like that? Now, granted, Komamura is a werewolf and doesn't have a heart, so does that mean that Komamura will continue to live on forever? And maybe that this is what the Grand Elder's job is to eat the hearts of his clanmen, so as long as he's alive, then his clansmen who gave up their hearts will continue to stay alive. But again, we're getting into some theory stuff that just really doesn't matter. But it's an interesting, like, double-edged sword of what the Grand Elder's purpose is. So I guess the question to you guys is, did the Grand Elder set Komamura up? Other than that, we then move on to Kangdu and BG9. I did love this scene as well. I don't really care much for Kangdu or Shangdu or BG9 too much, but I did like this scene in particular because, of course, Uryu gets to make an appearance, which wasn't in the manga, and he's the one that kind of brings them into the shadow or brings them into the Vandan Reich, which then when he comes to BG9, one, I love the reflection in BG9's helmet, but you can also see Kangdu as well within shadows kind of knocked out. So Uryu did light work with Kangdu, and then he's probably going to do the same to BG9, and then we're going to see the result of that next episode. So it's actually interesting to see that Uryu is in fact getting his hands dirty. And then we get to the part of which I don't like. Now I would like to say, after this episode, where did all the Bambi out of hate come from? Oh, she deserved it. No, she didn't. Because she killed hot guys? Bear in mind, they're all the enemy. Like, they're all bad guys. She killed all bad guys, right? Like, she is a bad person herself, but she's killed bad soldiers, right? Like, they might be hot, but they're bad. Anyway, the point is, if you want to kill off Bambiata, kill her off. The thing that I don't like is what happens to Bambiata afterwards. It's cruel, it's inhumane, and I don't think she deserves that kind of treatment. However, somebody in the comment section did bring up that if it wasn't for Giselle, then Bambiata would have been treated much like Kangdu and BG9 will be, which is being unalived. As much as there's no winning here, I probably would have maybe have preferred that, unless Kubo wants to change something in the light novels and bring it back, please. But that being said, the Giselle thing is really interesting to me. Because people say, oh, well, Candice, Meninas, and Latoto actually allowed Giselle to do this, so they're also in the blame. So what the dialogue is basically saying from Giselle here is that poor little Bambi, the girls would be upset if you were to die here or something like that, right? It seems like all the girls know that Bambi is the strongest, and it seems that through the manga and even in the anime that they're all aware that Bambi is the strongest and maybe want to overthrow her in some way. It seems like all the Bambi girls in general want to have equal competition with each other, so to say. But the interesting thing is Giselle says that poor Bambi, we'd all be lonely without you. Now, my first reaction would be, well, okay, if you just leave her alone, she looks fine. She just needs a little bit of healing and she'll probably get back on her feet. She does look fine. She's laying on the ground. She's not dead. She's not bleeding out or anything. She looks completely fine. However, someone in the comments did say that if it wasn't for Giselle, then Uryu would have treated her with the same treatment. Was this choice by Giselle, which I don't think it is considering what I've read in the manga, was this choice by Giselle the best case scenario to keep Bambiata around? I don't think so. And do I think the Bambi goals let Giselle do this out of compassion for keeping her around? I also don't think so. But it seems to me that all the girls in general have this notion that whoever goes first or whoever dies gets this treatment. It would seem that everyone's kind of expects this to go this way. Even Bambiata herself understands that, you know, what Giselle's about to do to them. So it seems like a universal knowledge of this case, like almost like a, if you guys die, this is what's going to happen to you. Like a pact, so to say. But then again, it would seem really malicious to say that the girls would be lonely without you, considering what Bambiata becomes. It's not like Bambiata is Bambiata anymore. And maybe this is the first time the Bambi girls actually see Giselle do this as well, so they probably don't even know what the outcome is either. But at the end of the day, I just fucking hate Giselle. Like, honestly, I hope the worst for that character. Genuinely. And I wouldn't have minded it, but do you know what made it 10 times worse was the fact that the voice actor was just so good with that reaction. Like, you could hear the actual fear and the cry for help in that voice when they were saying, no, Gigi, don't do it. And it tore my heart to shreds. I don't care if you don't like Bambi. She's adorable. She's great. She's a villain. And that's what we like about her. She's a great villain. Like, she's fantastic. The weak have got to gang up on the strong mentality. Come on. Because that's what you are, Giselle. You're weak. You can't fight. You're mid as fuck. And you have to beat people when they're down because you can't fight for shit. Because you ain't shit. Anyway, I'm not going to make this into a Giselle hate video. even though I'd like it to. Then we move on to Harshwald and Shunsui, and to be honest with you, I didn't really care for this scene overall, because that scene specifically made to gas up Issei. Issei Nanao, to be specific. Apparently I said Isana in the live reaction, I don't know. But basically it was just to gas her up and say, look, hey, I can do really cool Kido, and here's this Kido that I just put up to make you fall into this potential trap. And then Harshwald's like, I'm going to do something. And then was like, wait, no, I can't, because my lord and savior Yuha Baha needs me. So the mouth needs to, you know, be moistened before he can go and see his lord and savior. Though in saying that, I will say this whole shot in general that you're seeing on screen right now was absolutely beautiful. You can put this on a wall. It just looks great. The colors, the reflections, the environment. Beautiful. In regards to Master Masculine, I found it funny. I feel like that crossbar or that clothesline from Shuhei was probably the best thing that I got from this little interaction, because it was just so clean and it felt so impactful. And to be honest with you, it was only the camera movements that made it look like that. The animation was great, especially like as he was throwing him to the ground afterwards, but that camera shake really gave it that sense of impact, and I really liked it because it was just sudden, it was quick, it was bam, done, no delay. So I really enjoyed that shot as a whole. But I will say, James and Master Masculine, I thought it was going to be honestly corny, these two characters. I was gonna be like, oh, okay, here's the joke character snooze fest, right? But I'm not gonna lie, James is killing it with the voice acting. I'm killing it with the voice acting. It's funny, it's goofy, but it's also terrifying, and I love it. However, during this interaction, we do get to see two pieces of light falling from the sky, and that is Rukia and Renji, spoiler alert. But it's quite nice that they were kind of hinted at, and we're going to see them next episode. Anyways, it's not really a spoiler. You're going to get to see them very shortly, so that's cool as well. Somebody was saying, oh, I'd like an explanation of how they actually got through the barrier. People just don't watch the series, because anyone that knows Bleach would know that the barrier just lets Soul Reapers in, you know? All that's changed is the environment of the Vandenreich. The barrier itself hasn't, in concept, changed. Soul Reapers can just come and go as they please. And then to end off that little segment, the Kensei scene of holding the foot was quite nice as well, because he's not acknowledging Mask, he's acknowledging Shuhei, telling him he's pathetic after all the training that they've done, and then he finally acknowledges his Mask. So the badass points are there for Kensei, and again, I hope he gets his justification within the anime. The manga, it was cool, but you know, if you know, you know, we'll talk about that when it happens. But I'm hoping he gets some really cool time to shine. And I think he will. I think he will get his bout next episode. So I'm excited for that. And then we get onto the most important part. Ichigo Kurosaki. The end of the path has finally come. We're finally there at the end. Senjimaru getting the robes, getting the fit for the next episode, probably coming down. Like, I don't think he's going to arrive in the Soul Society, but I do think he's definitely going to be on his pathway to the Soul Society. I think that will definitely be the end credits, but let's talk about what happens. Now, thankfully, all of this is done now. Not thankfully, but, you know, when you get given barely anything as a little bit of a cock tease, it's kind of nice to see that it's all concluded, so we can kind of put that chapter together and see it as a whole. Now, again, I'm still sticking to my guns. I think the dialogue was pretty self-explanatory. Ichigo's body was crumbling, but also he withstood the power. Now, it says from Ichibe that the weight you feel is what you're trying to protect. Now, what Ichigo is trying to protect is all the worlds. Waikomunda, World of Living, Soul Society, he's trying to protect it all. Now, I have to stress, Hell is not a part of the Soul King. Hell has existed since day one, even before the Soul King, potentially. The Soul King, the Soul Reapers, Waikomunda, all those people, they have no say or no law in regards to what happens in Hell. It's its own separate entity. Hell is not considered a part of the world of which the Soul King is keeping stable or at bay. Let's get that right down the middle. But yeah, so Ichigo is holding on everything that he considers things that he wants to protect, which is a massive, heavy burden. Can you protect these things that you want to protect so badly? Okay, you say you want to protect these things? Have a taste of it. Here's all that weight on your shoulders, and here is the reality of can you protect it or not? And he seems to have flown with flying colours. However, what we also then get to see is obviously the Soul King putting powers into Ichigo's vessel, or quotation, his body, to see if he can withstand it. Chances are, I will concede a little bit on the possibility that yes, the Soul King is putting some power into him, but probably nothing of what you expect the Soul King to be in terms of power. Like, he's not putting all of his power into Ichigo, maybe a smidgen, right? But what is interesting is something that Ichibei said again, which is what you see is the power of the Soul King. So these are things that he is seeing, right? He's seeing the power of the Soul King. He's not obtaining it. And the details are within the words. Read the words literally. He is seeing the power. And if he can see that power and if he can withstand that power, then he can keep proceeding to what he needs to be. So are all the rainbow colors are in symbolism to each of the worlds? That's quite possible. I don't disagree with anyone in that front. Or is it Shinigami, Hollow, Fullbringer, Human? Now, if you don't know what these things are, I'll give a brief on what I think that they are. I did an Ichigo character development video. I do recommend you go check it out. I think it still holds true to this day. But we talk about the Mitamas. And what the Mitamas are, essentially different pieces of energy based on Buddhist and Shinto beliefs. So like, for example, you have the Quincy soul, which is called the Wondrous soul, or the Human soul, which is the Harmonious soul. And then you have like the Hollow, which is like the Anger soul. I can't remember off the top of my head what it was called. It was called like the Neki Mitama or something like that. But regardless of what, it's kind of based off like Shinto slash Buddhist beliefs. So it's cool to see that Kubo is still keeping to those concepts. And then another interesting thing is that we get to see like these black orbs on Ichigo. Now, is this foreshadowing to something that may be happening later on down the road? Because we do see some black orbs. Again, for those that like don't want to be spoiled, basically there's these black orbs that turn up later on in the series. And I'm wondering if these are the same black orbs that are on Ichigo, which is interesting because these black orbs don't really consume him. Like, they try to, but the consumption doesn't work. And I'm wondering if that's the parallel between Yuha and Ichigo in this sense. If you know, you know. I'm not gonna elaborate any further. And again, at the end, we get Senjimaru. So we get Mommy Soifon, is what we all call her. And yeah, she's in the red room with all that fabric. What is she gonna cook for our dripping boy Ichigo? But again, I love that Ichigo doesn't complain. He doesn't moan. He's just out there straight away saying, what's next? Like, he's ready to go to the next step and he's just not willing to wait around. So I think it speaks volumes on how headstrong Ichigo is, how strong his will is, and how strong his perseverance is in comparison to something like, you know, the Wake and Wonder arc or the Fullbring arc. You know, Ichigo is a different breed. He's matured, he's gotten stronger mentally and physically, and I think that at the end was the perfect example of showing that. So with that being said, another long review. I'm going to catch you guys later. You guys, of course, have this fine day been handsome. And are we going to get a banger for next episode? I believe so. So, but with that being said, you guys, of course, have this fine day been handsome. I'm going to catch you guys later. And as always, people, peace out.